Joined now by TSN hockey analyst, former Vancouver Canuck and Pittsburgh Penguin, Mr. Frank Corrado. How we doing?
Good. All good in here. If you hear any sirens or horns blasting or anything like that, I'm in New York and my hotel room is low to the ground here. So yeah, I'm getting a full dose of the Big Apple. Right
good
now.
Mood lighting too. You look like you're in like a nice urban lounge. It's good. Mm-hmm. Yeah,
that's right. Well, yeah. You know what? Like the stanchion comes on here and he's got like his crazy backdrop like made for podcasts. So we'll set the mood a little bit.
Yeah, exactly.
Are you getting time for a show? A deli? You know, what's the social plan in New York?
I didn't get a lot of sleep last night. I don't know. It's like being a player. Sometimes after a game, you just can't sleep. And then I was up at 5:30. But I do, like, I have two things planned here. I want to grab a slice for sure. And then, like, I don't know. I always grab a bagel in New York. Like, nothing crazy. I'm just going to, I'm going to get some steps in today. That's my plan after this.
There you go. Great walking city. And nobody does the red checkered board Italian better than New York City.
Oh, yeah.
So I'm sure you'll find a place. Everyone I talk to talks about how Phil Kessel is beloved by his teammates. And I know his teammates also take great amusement with him. You played with Kessel in Pittsburgh. What is it about the guy that seems to light up all of his ex-teammates?
I think he's just a very genuine guy. Like there's nothing fake about him. Like he'll be very honest with you. And for better or for worse, but like he just goes by everything he does very honestly. And like I can give you a couple good examples. Like, so I had been called up to Pittsburgh and Phil and I had kind of struck up a little conversation talking about the guys in Toronto. Like he knew them so well. He had spent so much time there. And we were down in Detroit. And the hotel you stay at in Detroit, there's a good steakhouse in there. And, you know, sometimes you don't want to venture too far off and whatever. So I just went down to the bar. He was already eating dinner down there. So I just, you know, I was going to eat dinner at the bar. He goes, yeah, come sit with me. And he wanted to know how all his boys in Toronto were doing. How's JVR? How's this guy? How's that guy? You know, we were kind of like two guys who like hockey, who didn't really know each other very well, but had one thing in common, the Toronto connection. And just talking about that team and what that team entails, and almost being like two fans kind of sitting around at a bar watching, you know, watching the game, kind of talking hockey. So I thought that was really cool. And like, even, you know, on the ice, like he has a high standard for his game, the game of people around him. And it kind of, you can see it, like some of the clips that he's had over the years with Pittsburgh, where he's coming back to the bench and he's pissed off and he's looking at Tocchet and they're going back and forth. And like, he goes by everything very honestly and very genuine. And I think that's the reason why guys really are drawn to his personality.
It doesn't seem like there's an ego at all. There's a confidence. Like we've seen some intense sort of conversations on the bench with Tocchet and other coaches too, of just about gameplay. And that sort of thing. So there's confidence, but it doesn't seem like there's an ego there that he struts around like I'm Phil Kessel.
No, God, no. No, the furthest thing from that, like he'll just walk into the gym with like his flip-flops on and a coffee and look at the guys and that's cool. Like, you know, like just something like that, right? But like speaking of the gym, like he's, you know, I never trained with him in the off season. I obviously got to see the in-season stuff, but there's like legendary stories about him training in Toronto in the off season with like, you know, all the pro guys, whether it's Gary Roberts or all these guys that would train together. And he would, you know, he'd go on a little fishing trip and then come back and he would still be stronger and more explosive than all the guys that had been there, like grinding away. Like it was like guys would say like, no, this guy's a genetic freak. Like what he's able to do and just, you know, hop into the gym, throw some weights on a sled or, you know, throw some weight on the bar and watch what this guy can do. Like it was very impressive. Those are kind of like the little, you know, summertime urban legends of Phil Kessel in the gym in Toronto.
Well, you may have just answered this with the genetic freak thing, but I was going to ask, like he's kind of a throwback. He's a different shape than your modern hockey player. He's got the different hairline, the different look, the different attitude. how does he get it done? Like, what is his genius on the ice? What has sustained him being a top line and scoring NHL player for so long?
Well, I mean, he does play a brand of hockey that would lend itself to longevity. You know, like he's not the first one running in there, crashing and banging. You know, he's not really putting himself in the line of fire very often. But I will say this, with all that being said, he's played a long time in the NHL. He's 36 years old now. You would think at some point you would pop a groin, or your back would hurt, or you'd tear something, or just sometimes maybe you just get caught with some shrapnel and you miss a game or two. Like you take a look at his hockey DB. All I see is 82s. I see a 70, a 56, and a 42. It's like, it's crazy that he was able to play that long and get through it so unscathed. So, like, he's obviously a very intelligent hockey player to be able to do that. But it kind of goes back to that, what I was saying, like there's not too many guys that are built the way he's built. And that's, it sounds weird to say, because he's not like cut like a Greek god. We know what Phil's all about, but it has a little bit to do with that. It also has a little bit to do with the style of game he plays. It obviously lends itself to sticking around and being available more often than not.
Didn't we all have that guy in high school who didn't work out at all, that was just freakishly strong and no one really knew why? And you wonder if like just inherent good core strength has kept him as durable as you're talking
about.
Well,
we should say 70 and 56, those were the pandemic shortened seasons,
right?
Like
exactly.
This was an Ironman at one point.
Yeah. He was a good skater too. You know, even at 36, even if a good skater loses a step, he's probably still at worst an average skater, right?
I would think so. Like, yeah. And that goes back to the explosiveness that he has. But yeah, like Phil in his prime down the wing, like a really fast skater, tough to handle one-on-one that way. And like, I would imagine like he probably is a guy who can pick it up very quickly. Like, I don't think it would be a long adjustment period for him. Like, he did played 82 regular season games last year. Guy still had 14 goals. So, like, I don't think you just lose it that quick. And Vegas was a very deep team. And the thing you need to remember about Vegas last year, especially, they had all their players lower in the lineup so perfectly slotted that they provided something that other teams couldn't counteract. You know, like they had like your guy like William Carrier lower in the lineup, Nicholas Waugh. It's like those guys are really hard to play against. Like those guys provide something that Phil couldn't do. So he probably needed to play higher in the lineup, but those spots were taken come playoff time. So like as much as, you know, you could talk about, yeah, he wasn't really in the mix and in Vegas in the playoffs, he played four games, but I think it also has something to do with the fact that Vegas was really well built and they had other competitive advantages lower in the lineup that they needed to utilize in order to win. And they did that.
You've called Tockett the Kessel Whisperer with us before. Rick's a hard on the puck, chip and chase, forecheck with ferocity type of guy. And as we've just described, that is not Phil Kessel's game. How did these two become so close? What is it about Kessel that Tockett takes a shine to?
I'm not sure how it kind of originated. Like I know just from being around there a little bit, you know, there were some bigger personalities on that team. And what I mean by that is like people who are very competitive within the game of hockey, who want to win and want to drive others to win. And I think when you have players like that, it's a good thing. For sure. But it is, you do need to have some kind of buffer. And I think Tockett was that buffer, whether it was between him and Phil or Phil and Malkin. And, you know, like it was just, you needed that person that could kind of calm the waters. And I think Tockett was that guy. And Matt, to your point about, you know, the style of player that Tockett really likes, we see that in Vancouver and we've kind of seen that identity within this team. I'll also, you know, say that he also knows how to use players to their strengths and not try and make them something they're not. And there's a difference for me with, you know, you could use the example of Kuzmenko, right? Like he probably saw something in Kuzmenko that he said, like, this kid hasn't really unlocked this yet. Like, I think there's something more there, and I want to drag it out of him. And that's different than Phil is what he is, and we've known it for a long time. And in Pittsburgh, they used him in a spot where, although his game wasn't, you know, crashing and banging and physical, you just used him in a way where you didn't have to ask that from him, and you got the most of him. And I think that's something important to keep in mind if he does end up playing for Vancouver. It's that Tocchet knows what he is, and he's going to try and put him in a position to succeed.
All right, what's your forecast for him here? Where do you think he should play? How much should he play? And he's 8 points away from 1,000, which would make him the 99th player in league history.
This is just enough games left where you'd think that's pretty reasonable to expect, even if he doesn't get in for another week and a half.
It's okay. Like, Vancouver, for me, has a lot of players really well slotted. So, I mean, ideally, you would think he's going to play higher in the lineup because that's where you're going to get the most out of him. Let's just say the third line is untouchable right now. Like, that third line is as good as any line in the NHL, so that's not going anywhere. You would think, okay, well, fourth line, is that how you work him into the lineup? But he's not a fourth line player. And, you know, with the way the fourth line kind of looks right now, DiGiuseppe's back. You have Mikheyev playing lower in the lineup. Like, Sam Lafferty has been really good. So I'm not exactly, like, convinced that he needs to play lower. And, you know, so you take a look at the second line. JT Miller, Besser, like, Pusser. I mean, how does he get in on that line? Because that line has to eat some matchups. And so it is interesting to see where he plays. Like, I would imagine he's got to start lower, like, lower in the lineup. I'm convinced that he has to start lower in the lineup, and it's not going to be the third line, so that leaves it as the fourth line. But that does something to your identity of your team. So I could be really wrong on this. Maybe he does, like, if he does end up playing, he goes higher in the lineup. But I think they've got a few checkpoints to go before they kind of come to that decision. Like, I think he's got to go to Abbotsford. He's got to show that he's in shape, or he's got to get in shape. He's got to play well down there. And then you'll kind of go from there. And maybe you'll have injuries by that point. Like, I think that's also something to keep in mind with Kessel. It's like, you're almost hedging and saying, okay, it's not going to cost us an asset to bring him in. It's just going to cost us a contract spot. And, you know, if something happens in 2 weeks where someone goes down, we got a guy that we're comfortable with, and we know we can put him in, and we know exactly what he is. It didn't cost you anything other than a contract and some prorated money. So I kind of see it as a little more insurance rather than, okay, we got to get him in right away and see how he's going to help us, immediately.
Yeah, I think that's exactly what it is.
Yep. Blueger, Joshua, Garland. Best third line in the league?
Best line ever, period.
The best line ever assembled in the game of hockey.
Yeah.
The best third line in the league, this debate was going on earlier in the season between the Dallas third line, which had Marchment, Duchesne, and Sagan, and a little bit with the Winnipeg third line with Appleton, Niederreiter, and Lowry. Now that the Dallas third line is, like, being listed on paper as the second line, which it never was the third line anyways. But as of right now, I can't think of a third line that's better than those guys. And quite honestly, they're playing and they're having more of an immediate impact than a lot of, like, second and first lines on other teams. So credit to them. But the other thing that really kind of stands out for them right now is throughout the course of a game, there's not a lot of shifts where they're on the ice and nothing is happening. Mm. It's like they get on the ice and quickly something's happening. Like, there's something to the net, or there's a rush chance, or they got in on the forecheck and they caused a turnover and they're playing in the offensive zone. I don't know. It's quite a compliment to them that they can get on the ice and they can make something happen pretty quickly. And you know, there's some lines that go through a game and you're like, oh, like, where were they? Were they on the, like, I haven't seen, maybe it was a little bit of like a neutral zone kind of choppy shift, not them. Like they win their shift a lot. And I know even like last night was an easier opponent in Chicago, but you still have to do it. And they did a great job of that. And I think that's the thing that stands out is just how soon after they get over the boards, they're making something happen. They're getting right to work.
Well, the other thing is the third line generally, and these guys too, often will get you the dig the puck out of the corner, center to the open guy, shoots and scores. You know, like that's generally the simplicity of a third line role. The chemistry of these guys, and we've talked about chemistry before, it's unfathomable to me what level of chemistry they have right now in that they're scoring Sedin-like goals. Like the give and go goal, like how does each of them know, you know, that they're going to be ready for those sorts of passes? Neither one of those passes were the easiest passes to make. They make them. The little stick lift for Garland, knowing that his man's in the slot behind him on the Joshua goal. Like, this, again, we expect the Sedins to process at that level, but a huge compliment to all three of these guys. They're processing, like, at a superstar level there. It's unbelievable.
It really is, and it has something to do with the fact that, like, I think all of those three guys think the game the same way, and they have a little bit of greasiness to them.
They
have, like, what I mean by that is, like, and you kind of alluded to it there. It's like a little stick lift, and there's a certain level of gamesmanship that all three of those guys have. And I think, like, Garland has always had that, and Tocchet really wanted to see that out of Dakota Joshua this year. Like, remember early in the year, we're talking about Rick Tocchet being really hard on that player, and is it necessary? And turns out it was necessary because there was another level for him to get to, and he's obviously gotten to it now. But all three of those guys, they kind of, like, they have the same game plan. They have the same mentality to the way they want to play. It's fast. It's direct. It's in your face. Like, that Dakota Joshua, I would not want to play against that guy. Like, he's a menace. Like, he finishes every hit. He wins a lot of battles. He asserts himself in front of the net. Like, and with the way you have to play defense now, you can't cross-check and box out the way you used to. So he's taking full advantage of that. Like, I don't know. All those guys kind of have the same thought process in the way they want to play the game. And it works really well. And they all kind of complement each other. There's no kind of, hey, we got to drag this guy along because, you know, he's just not quite with us. It's like they almost all push each other to do a little bit better.
You played with Blueger in Pittsburgh. Did you see him turning into this kind of a player and being the center on what is potentially the best third line in the NHL? Well,
so I got to play with him his rookie year in the minors, and I was always impressed with his work ethic. Like, he was a kid who, like, when he signed his deal, you could tell he was never going to take the easy way out or take any kind of shortcut. Like, I remember – And I, you know, myself and some veteran guys, we would put in a good effort. We would shoot some pucks after practice, and we would be, you know, done our cool down, done our shower, leaving the rink. And this guy would just be getting off the ice, and his stick blade was, you know, barely had any tape left on it and covered in snow. And he had picked up all the pucks by himself. Like, he really made a point early in his career to be the hardest working player he possibly could be. So I give him a lot of credit in that regard. He doesn't come about it accidentally. And I think, you know, when you see someone who's established that early in their career, and then they get to the NHL, they have a good understanding of what it takes to get there. And more importantly, what it takes to stay there. And he's not afraid to work. Like, and I think that's really important. He's not afraid to say, it's been a hard week. We had back-to-back games. You know, we had a hard practice. We had a hard skate. It's pretty easy for someone to say, I'm just going to go home, take it easy today. And, you know, but he's the kind of guy where it's like, no, I'm actually going to put in another round of work because I know, like, this is going to benefit me. So, I always kind of saw Teddy being like a player lower in the lineup that was going to be a workhorse kind of guy who could make some plays, score some goals. Like, he scored some big overtime goals for us when he was a rookie. And that kind of sticks out in my memory. But he always went about it with this work ethic that he wanted to be unmatched by his peers.
So the question is, at the end of this season with Dakota Joshua and Ted Blueger needing contracts, and yet the Canucks, of course, needing to give a raise to Philip Ronick and Elias Pettersson and OEL money and all that, they're going to run out of dough pretty quick. Do they owe it to themselves to ensure that Joshua and Blueger go nowhere, even though it's going to snooker them, paint them into a corner that has already been painted into at this point?
I know. This is the thing that the Canucks have kind of gotten themselves into now that other good teams have had to deal with. It's like you get these players on some value deals. They do really well for you and you're a good team. Now they're more exposed. Now the cat's out of the bag. Everyone wants these guys. You got to pay a premium or else someone else is going to do it. And I think from what we've seen around the league with these kind of situations, you're better off trying to acquire that version of that player again.
Yep.
You know what I mean? Like if you overpay, like if you overpay and you give those guys too much term, you're paying for what you got the previous year. You need to try and find that version in this year's crop, whether it's a trade or probably a UFA, which is difficult. It's difficult. And we've seen a lot of teams just say, you know what? We don't want to leave it to chance. We know what this guy is. And guess what? You sign him for a lot, like you give him a lot of years, you give him a lot of money. You're like, oh man, would love to get out from that contract. And time will tell. Like, you don't know if that's the case, but we do have a larger sample size now in the NHL with the flat cap, the way it's been, where teams that have kind of, for the most part, teams that have kind of walked away and said, hey, we're just going to try and find the next version of you, have been better suited. The one example that does come to mind is the Leafs not re-signing Zach Hyman. Like, I think that one hurts every time Hyman scores a goal in Edmonton or has a big night. But in Toronto's defense, they got Michael Bunting and had him for 2 years at $950,000. And statistically, he outperformed what Hyman had done in Toronto the two previous years. So I'm not saying, like, Zach Hyman, that deal should have been done in Toronto. But, like, they went out and tried to find that version of him, and they had success. So
it's sad for the fans, right? Because the fans have established this emotional bond with these guys. But business is business, and I fully agree. And you think about like a Jay Beagle, who the Benning regime brought in here. Jay Beagle sort of established himself as a good character role player, got some shine on him, but they gave him 4 years of decent money, and they rued every day of it.
Well, I mean, how many times did you guys see that example with the last regime, where it was like we're going to pay these guys that are, you know, a little over the hill, but great guys. We're going to give them big money and give them term. It's like, why? You could just find that guy again. It's tough decisions, especially when you got to explain them. But there's plenty of examples where teams have kind of, you know, found someone a little more on the cheap who can provide the same kind of service.
Yeah.
Lastly, Frankie, I'm not sure if you caught Jake Walman and the gritty celebration. I'm not sure if you caught Nikita Zadorov with a bad hit to the head of Lucas Raymond. Are we beyond the point of retribution, ugly incidents in the National Hockey League, particularly when one team is fighting for a playoff spot like Detroit is? Or would you anticipate there's some spiciness in Thursday's game?
I would think there's going to be some spiciness. I did see, like, the big celebration, the big grand celebration, it is a little bit much. But I also saw a video that he had pointed to some kids in the stands that were, like, doing the gritty or something. And he, you know, so there's that angle to it. I don't know. I mean,
it was Kids Day there at Little Caesars Arena. So there were a lot of kids. And,
you know, maybe that might be a little talking to. That might just be a little skate by. We didn't appreciate that. Like, you know, don't do that kind of stuff. I don't know. I don't think that one turns into the Morgan Riley cross check.
Okay, I was just going to say, just so long as this game is the silver medalist this week on the code.
Yeah.
Because no one can compete.
Bronze
with Greg.
Where were you?
And with our boy Morgan Riley. You buck him up, okay? Because that's a big time suspension.
I've heard stories. Okay, where were you when Canada, Soviet Union, the 72 summit series? Where were you when the OJ Simpson trial went down? Where were you, Matt and Blake, when Morgan Riley cross checked Ridley Gregg?
Yeah.
You will never forget where you were.
Yeah, it was quite a moment. More on the hockey panels tonight, I'm sure. Story's not dead.
Yeah, I heard actually we're doing a 30 for 30 on it.
Are we really? Okay, swing that documentary team into action.
I've heard there's some conspiracy. There might have been a second cross-checker.
And the Senators mocked it in their intermission last night.
Have a barber doing that.
Brilliant as always, Frank. Magnificent insights here into particularly some of your former teammates there and what's making them tick. Appreciate this. Until next week.
All right, boys. Talk soon. Mm-hmm.
Hey, everybody. If you're enjoying what you're seeing here, then follow along with Sekeres and Price on YouTube. I promise more content coming.
The kids call it subscribe on YouTube.
Well, how about liking it?
Do that as well. Smash it right now.